Hello, my name is Pastor Tim Brewington, and I am the pastor of Fellowship Church. At Fellowship Church, we're just ordinary people who have experienced extraordinary life in Jesus Christ. And our mission is to tell others what we have experienced so that they too can experience this wonderful Jesus that we serve. I would like to send a personal invitation to you, your friends, and your family to join us at one of our worship services. You will find that we are a community of believers that focus on the Word of God, worship, and praise. During our worship services, we believe in just letting the Holy Spirit have His way. So please, join us at one of our worship services. God bless you.
We come to glorify His name.
Would you clap your hands for Jesus one more time?
Hallelujah.
Glory. While you're standing, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to glorify your name today, for you are great and worthy of the praise. You are faithful and good to us. We thank you for the privilege it is to come into your house today with our heads lifted up, our mouths filled with praise to you. We look back, we can say you've been good to us. Hasn't always been easy, but you've been good to us. Went through some tough times, didn't know how we were going to make it, but you always showed up, right? In the nick of time, hallelujah. We thank you, God, that your faithfulness has brought us to this moment in this day and in our lives that we have not seen before. So we appreciate it. And now, God, I pray that you would speak to us. Give us an ear to hear what you would say to the church. We've heard many voices this week, many opinions on the news, from family, friends. We've even had conversations with ourselves about what's going on. But today, we are eager to hear what you have to say. Oh yes, speak to us. Because only what you say matters. Every other voice is a lie. Only you are true. Prepare our hearts and our minds to receive your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. As you are being seated, please turn in your Bibles to the 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, and we'll begin our reading, verse number 6. Before we read verse number 6, I want to give you some information about 1 and 2 Peter. 1 and 2 Peter is rich with words of encouragement given to believers who are struggling, who are suffering, and through their suffering, they're trying to hold on to their faith. Not only does it assure us that we are not alone in our suffering, but 1 and 2 Peter tells us that God has a plan. Can I tell you, nothing is wasted with God. No tear is wasted, no challenge is wasted. Nothing just happens to us. But Peter tells us that God has a plan. Then he reveals that God's plan deals harshly with those who are the cause of our suffering, the source of it. But then he also says that he rewards us greatly for remaining faithful even through our suffering. So I want to encourage you in your own time to read 1 Peter and 2 Peter. You could do it in one or two sittings. Both chapter books combined only have 8 chapters, and each chapter is a short chapter. If you are struggling with understanding what God is doing, and is there a purpose? Is there a plan? Am I alone in this? I encourage you to read 1 Peter and 2 Peter. This morning, I'm drawing your attention to chapter 5. But in chapter 1, the Apostle Peter reminds us that God has given us a living hope. A living hope is a hope that is not dead. It is a hope that is relevant. It is a hope that is right now. Hope is expectation. So a living hope means that we are living in our expectation. That means even if we have not received what we have expected, because you're not expecting something that you already have. When you're in a place of expectation, you're still waiting for what you expect to happen. But a living hope says, I'm living like I have it, even though I don't. Oh, I don't have a church. A living hope says, he promised me something, so I'm going to live as if I already have it. From a theological standpoint, that's how we view salvation. We are saved. In a moment, we are saved. We are being saved because salvation is a process. It's taking off the old and putting on the new. But then one day, we will be saved. That means it will be complete, where sin will no longer be a threat or hindrance. There will be no struggle. So I am delivered today. I am being delivered, but my expectation is one day I will be completely delivered. That's what he reminds them of in chapter 1. In chapter 2, the Apostle Peter reminds us that we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession. It's interesting that he reminds the church who they are in their times of suffering, in their times of difficulty, because when you're going through difficult times, that's when you question your identity the most. Like, what did I do to cause this? Why is this happening? Am I alone in this? He says, wait a minute, understand this. You are God's chosen people, a holy nation. You're a royal priesthood. You are God's possession. You belong to God. So that does two things. The first thing it tells us is that we are not alone. We belong to God, and he knows what he is doing in our lives. But the second thing he tells us this for is so that we will know how to live godly in an ungodly world. The Bible says that we are the light of the world. We are a city that sits on a hill, and we cannot be hidden. So he reminds us that even though you may be tempted to give in to the dominant culture around you, remember that you are a peculiar people. You are a holy nation. You are a royal priesthood. Please believe that the royals live differently than the dominant culture. They have different expectations than the dominant culture. And he says, you are God's royal priesthood. So live differently. It's tempting when the world is pressing up against you. It's tempting to give in. He says, no, you got to remember that you belong to God. Chapter 3, he gives instructions on how to have a godly marriage. It's interesting that in this book, where he's talking about suffering, all of a sudden he changes the subject to marriage. suffering marriage. I don't know. I'm just saying, it's just interesting to note. So he says, even in your suffering, in the dominant culture that is against family, against marriage, he says, I want you to know how you can have a godly and a healthy marriage, even in the culture that hates the very thing that God loves. And then that same chapter, he tells us how to handle insults. Come on. How many of us have done some things that we wish we didn't do because somebody insulted us and we didn't handle it the right way? Why y'all looking at me crazy? Huh? Y'all know some of us got insulted and the fist went like this, or the mouth said some words, put them together, put them apart. So he teaches us, listen, even when you are insulted, there's a way that you are to respond to your insult, because you got to remember that you are a holy nation. You are God's property. So you cannot respond to insults the same way that the world responds to insults, although you are tempted. Chapter 4, he gives more insight on the suffering for Christ's sake. He says that as believers, we must be reminded that there are always consequences. When you choose to follow Christ, there are always consequences to that. It's going to cost you something. And what we miss up on is that we think that if I follow Christ, then the rest of my life will be easy. If I choose Christ, then my difficulties and my struggles are going to go away. Peter says, no, you need to understand that your suffering is not because you rejected Christ, but because you chose him. They persecuted him, they will persecute you. So finally, we get to chapter 5, where we will spend the remainder of our time. The first part of chapter 5, the first few verses, he gives instructions to the elders and the pastors. And he tells them to watch over God's flock and be a good example to them. He says they need examples, they need someone to care for them, and it's your responsibility to watch over them and care for him. And then he says, but don't lord over them. Don't try to rule over them or dominate them. But serve them, not because you have to, but because God has called you to. It's a privilege to be called to serve God's people. So he says, remember, because they're going through difficulty, they're going through suffering, and you're going through your own suffering. And you know, sometimes when you're upset and the person you are with is upset, that is a lethal combination for some things to happen. And Peter says, don't do that. They belong to God. Don't lord over them. Serve them because God has called you. And then in verse 6, he shifts his attention to the body of believers who are suffering and may be wondering what God is doing. Why is God allowing such suffering to take place? And I don't know about you, but I've had times in my life when I've been going through things and I've question God, why are you allowing certain things to happen? Why does it have to be so difficult? Why has it been so long? I just got over one challenge. Why am I right back into another challenge? I'm just feeling better over the condition I had 2 months ago, and now I'm right back into a whole nother condition. God, why are you allowing such things to happen? And so Peter gives us two instructions. First of all, he gives us what we should do during these times of suffering. And then he tells us what God is doing through our suffering. So verse number 6, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 6. First thing he says is, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may lift you up in due time. Here's the first thing you do when you're facing these challenges. You humble yourself before God. You accept what God allows. You give your life over to him. You say, God, I don't understand it. I don't like it. I don't appreciate it. But I accept what you have allowed in my life. I'm not going to fight it. I'm not going to kick and scream about it. I'm going to accept it. I saw a video a few months back of this man who grew up as the only child in his family. And his whole goal in life was to get up, grow up, get married, and have a large family. And that's what he did. He got married, had 8 kids. Then he was a Jewish man, so he went to synagogue on one Sabbath, decided to go to a friend's house afterwards. While he was gone, his house that had his wife and 8 children caught on fire. And 7 of those children died that day. He didn't find out about it until he finally picked up his phone. Y'all know how those rare occasions we turn our phones off. I know we don't do it often, but there are some people who actually turn their phone off. He turned his phone off, saw all these messages, and that's how he found out that 7 of his 8 children were dead. He took their body back to Jerusalem, stood in front of 7 caskets, and he asked God, why? Why would you allow such things to happen? So he was interviewed a few years after that, and he was asked, how is it that you are able to survive? Because he seemed to shift in his life, and he went on and he started ministering to people who are dealing with grief and loss. And he asked him, how is it that you were able to deal with such great loss and move on? You know what he said? He said, I accepted God's will. He realized, he said, resisting God's will increases suffering. Y'all heard what I said? Resisting God's will increases your suffering. We think that if I accept it, that the pain is going to get worse. If I acknowledge it, the pain is going to get worse. So I'm going to fight it. Why did this happen? This can't be right. This is not fair. I don't deserve this. But he said at the moment when he accepted God's will, the suffering lifted. And he said it wasn't a one-time thing. He said every time it rose up, I had to humble myself again. He said, I humbled my life to God's will. He said, God, I asked you for a large family, and you gave me that family. I didn't know you were going to take 7 of them in one day. But the more he accepted God's will, his suffering lifted. Wow, so Peter says, humble yourselves. Verse number 7, the next thing, which goes right into what I just talked about. Verse number 7, he says, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. So what do? When you're facing difficulty, the first thing you do is humble yourself. Accept God's will. Understand that God knows more than you know. He understands more than you understand. He is a wise and faithful God. And then he says, after you have humbled yourself, then give God what you care about. He says, cast your care. You know what it means to cast? Cast doesn't mean pass. Cast means forcefully throw. That moment when you are overwhelmed with care and anxiety, you take that and say, God, this belongs to you. The moment when you're feeling overwhelmed with anxiety and fear over what's going to happen in the future, what's going on in your body, he says, cast your care upon him. He says, this is why you do it, because he cares for you. That means he is taking care of you. Here is what the adversary doesn't want you to know when you are facing difficulty. He wants you to think that you are not being cared for, that nobody has your back, that nobody's looking out for you, and you're all alone. alone. But Peter reminds the church that his suffering, he says, listen, God still has your back. If you're worried about anything, if you're worried, how is this going to turn out? What's going to happen to my children? What's going to happen in my community? What's going to happen in my family? If you're worried about anything, he says, give it to God. Why? Because he's taking care of you. Oh, man. For me, there is nothing better than knowing that God's taking care of me. Because people love you, but they can't take care of you like God can. The person who loves you the most, there's only but so much they can do for you. But with God, there is nothing he can't do. The richest man in the world has limited resources when it comes to what God has. You may have a gazillion dollars and you may own property in every country on this planet. That is nothing compared to what God owns. God owns the universe. The earth is a speck in the universe. If you can buy this world, you are still poor when it comes to God. And that is who is taking you. That's who's taking care of you. Thank you, Dana. That is who has your back. He says, give me everything you care about, because guess what I care about? I care about you. Hallelujah. And let me say this and I'll move on. You must do this over and over and over again. It's not a one-time moment. It's not a one-time, let me have a quick prayer. Okay, God, I put my son in your hands. I know you have a plan for his life, and then I'm moving on with my life. But then 2 days later, when anxiety comes up, you have to do it again and say, God, I give him back to you. I don't know why I picked him up yesterday, but today I'm giving him back to you. Then he says this. So verse 6 says, be humble. Verse 7 says, give God what you care about. Then verse 8, he says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. Let's be clear here. We have a real adversary. It's not our imagination. Things that are happening to us that don't make sense, there is a spiritual war that we are engaged in. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but of principalities and powers and wickedness in high places. You have an adversary, and your adversary is going around like a lion who has not eaten in months, looking for someone to devour. So you wonder why you're always running up against something? You wonder why there's always a struggle, always a fight? You wonder why you take one deep breath and the next one is harder than the first one? Why? Because you have a real adversary that is looking for someone to devour. But understand this. He can't devour everybody. There's only a certain type of person that he can devour. Know who he can devour? People who are not alert and not sober-minded. Look at what he said. He says, be alert, pay attention, watch, be sober-minded, be serious about who you are and what's going on, because you have an adversary who is looking to devour you. Says you got to pay attention, meaning don't fall asleep. Don't doze off. There's too much going on in the world. This is not the time for the church to be taking naps. Huh? Wake up. You know who I'm talking to. Wake up. I'm almost done. No, I'm just kidding. This is not the time. He says, pay attention. There's a saying in our culture now that says, stay woke. The whole phrase, stay woke, means that you have to pay attention because you can't just take things as surface value. But there's something going on behind the scenes, and you need to make yourself aware of what's really going on so that you are not devoured by the adversary, so that you are not drawn in to what is happening. So our culture says you ought to stay woke, but the Bible says stay alert, pay attention. Then he says, be sober. That means don't be drunk. The opposite of sober is drunk. When you are drunk, you have a perverted view of reality. You think you are safe when you are in danger. You think you are in danger when you are safe. When you are drunk, you think you are stronger than what you really are and funnier than what you really are and wiser than what you really are. But everybody knows around you knows you are an ignorant drunk at this point. Says, don't get drunk. There's too much going on. You give yourself this sense that you can do all this. He said, pay attention. Don't be drunk. Now, let's not talk in metaphor here. For the believer, we need to pay attention to what we think about. Pay attention to what we do. Pay attention to what we believe. Look at your actions, look at your behavior, look at your pursuits, look at what you are getting involved in. Ask yourself the question, why am I doing this? Is this pulling me away from God? Because these are the avenues that the adversary uses to pull us away from God. Understand that his plan is to devour your faith. That's why the Bible says, resist him, standing firm in your faith. Pay attention to your habits. Pay attention to your behavior. Pay attention to the words that are coming out of your mouth. Pay attention to what you listen to and what you look at, because what you listen to and what you look at takes root in your spirit, and you begin to desire things that you didn't desire. Let me tell you, the longer you look at it, the more you are going to desire it. He says, pay attention. Know what's going on. If you're going through something, why is it? I mean, let me help somebody. Why do you think it is that when you are going through difficult times, one of the first things that the adversary wants you to stop doing is praying, reading your Bible, coming to church, and fellowshipping? Why do you think the attendance is low? Why? Because Satan knows if you hear the word, if you're reminded of who you are in God, then he can't devour you. Because here's what he does. When you don't hear the word, when you are going through, you feel like you're the only one going through. When you're not hearing the word and you're going through, you start believing nobody loves me. When you are going through and you're not hearing the word, you're feeling like there's no purpose for this. There's no plan. I might as well give up. But if you get into the congregation of the righteous and you hear the word, you are reminded that God is in control. He has a purpose and he has a plan, and you're going to make it. Generations before you went the same way and they all made it. Guess what? You're going to make it too. You're going to make it. Listen to what he says. Verse 9, he says, resist him, standing firm in the faith. Then he says this, listen, I'm almost done, I promise you. He says, believers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. These believers were isolated. They were spread throughout Asia Minor. And one of the things that happens when we go through difficult times is we start feeling isolated, like we're all by ourselves, like nobody else is going through. Everybody else's marriage is perfect. Everybody else's children are perfect. Everybody else has a good job. Everybody else has a good time in their family. Everybody else actually wants to go home for Thanksgiving, and I'm the only one. So you start feeling by yourself. Then you like, all the other believers, look, she had faith in God, and look at all these great things that I have. Everybody else prays, and they get healed. Everybody else prays, and they get increased. Everybody else does this, and things get better for them, but not for me. But Peter says, listen, you need to understand that the believers all around the world are going through the same suffering. It feels personal, but it's not. It feels like you are the only one, but you're not. The Bible says, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Jesus reminds us when we are persecuted that so persecuted they, the prophets that were before you. We are a part. Can I tell you, this is a great time to be a part of the body of Christ. This is a great time to be a part of the church, because guess what? The darker it is, the easier our job is to be the light. Y'all don't hear me. It's hard to show the significance of your light when the room is radiating like it is right now. But turn the lights off and have somebody light one little candle this big, and the whole room is impacted by that one little candle. He says, come on, that's what you are. So it's good that you're the only one in your family saved. Makes it easier for you to show them what Christ can do. It's good that you're the only one in your job who's walking for the Lord. Why? Because now it's easier for you to stand out. So it is a good opportunity for us to show the power of God, that even in this dark, and this is what he's telling, even in this dark world when we are going through our own suffering, guess what? We stand out as God's prized possession. And we show the world that there is still hope in Jesus, because our hope is living, meaning it's always relevant. I can always depend on it. The hope that my great-grandmother depended on, it's the same hope that I'm living in today. The same hope that Peter had when he wrote it is the same hope that we have today. But here's, and as you stand to your feet, here is what he says. Resist Satan's with your faith. Resist the temptation to walk away. Resist the temptation to give up and throw in the towel. Resist it with your faith. He said, resist it in the faith of Jesus Christ. Verse 10, so this is what we have to do. Humble ourselves. Give God what we care about. Resist the adversary. Stay alert. Verse 10 says what God is doing. Verse 10 says, and the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. King James Version says, he'll settle you. Y'all hear what I said? While we're going through, he says, listen, understanding that your suffering is a little while, and I'm already reading your mind. A little while is relative. A little while for God feels like a long time for us. But in the big scheme of things, he says, it's a little while. But that's not what I want you to focus on. What I want you to focus on is, if he says it's a little while, then what he's saying, that whatever suffering we are enduring now, there's an end date. That's something, Tony. at some point it will expire. That when we go into a moment of suffering, that God knows when it is going to begin, but guess what? It has an end date. It's not going to last forever. Hallelujah to God. And you don't get overtime. Our suffering doesn't get overtime and extra time, and you can't extend the time of your suffering. No, it has an end date. And here's what he says, and when you have endured your suffering, he said, God himself will restore you. So whatever you lost, you get it back. He said, then I'm going to strengthen you and settle you. You know what? Anybody tired of being unsettled? Over here one day, in the back another day, just going back and forth, not sure. One day you believe, and next day you don't believe. Let me tell you something. Going through periods of suffering will strengthen your faith. Let me tell you what I know for sure about God. I know because of what I suffered. I don't know it because of the mountaintop experience. I know it because when I went through the valley of the shadow of death, I realized that it's true. The Lord is with me. I have my faith is strengthened because I've had some enemies, and I found out it is true when David says in Psalm 23 that he prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemy. I have to move on, but what I love about God is that he will put you in the position where people who don't want to see you celebrate and have a banquet, who's been doing everything they can do to stop you from experiencing what God has for you. He won't give you a private banquet, but he will give you a public banquet in front of all the people who didn't want you to make it, and they have to watch. Oh, Lord, have mercy. He's going to strengthen you, my brother. There's a time period. Last point here. There are things that catch us by surprise. There are things that happen into our lives. Look, listen, I'm a living witness. I've prepared to fight a lot of battles in my life, but there's a certain thing that I was not prepared for. I wasn't expecting it at all. It caught me off guard. But it didn't surprise God. He knew exactly what would happen. And guess what I'm finding? I'm finding that daily he's giving me grace. That's why he said the God of all grace. Because what you need right now is grace. You think you need to get out the situation. You think things need to get better. No, what you need is grace. Grace to bear it. Grace to make it. That's what I pray for you today. I encourage you as we pray. I encourage you to pay attention, not to what people are doing, but to your own soul. What are you thinking about? How are you spending your time? What are you pursuing? Can you remember a time when you were more passionate about your relationship with God? Can you remember a time when you cared more about the lost than getting increases on your job and living comfortable? Can you remember a time when you really wanted to give your life totally over to God, and you said, Lord, I present myself to you. Whatever you want, I want. And now you've fallen asleep a bit because things got harder than what you expected. People thought that you thought were going to be there forever, walked away, and now you've fallen asleep a bit. I hear God say, stay awake, pay attention, be sober-minded. Last point, this is my third last point. Unless I get another one. He says, stand in the faith. Resist the devil. Stand firm in your faith. Why? Because what you believe is important. Hear what I'm saying. What you believe is important. Do not allow the adversary to move you from what you believe, because if you believe that God is faithful and he will be with you, then no matter what you go through, you know that he is with you. If you believe that because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that whatever you go through down here doesn't compare to the glory that shall be revealed in us in heaven, then you need to hold on to that when you're going through. And if that little while means the rest of your life, you know that this is not all we get. But Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. And if I go away, I'm coming again. And it is important that you believe that. Can I tell you, some things are not going to work out on this side, but that's okay, because this is not all we get. I am saved. I am being saved. But one day we will be saved. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Peter reminds the church, you're suffering here, but this isn't all we get. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness unto us. We thank you that we realize today that you know exactly who we are and where we are and what we are dealing with. We thank you, Lord, that you have let us know today that you have a purpose and a plan for everything that we are going through. I pray, God, that we will leave here in the comfort of knowing that your purpose and your plan is good, it is pleasing, and it is perfect. God, we pray that you give us the grace to humble ourselves before you, because you said if we do that, you will lift us up. At the right time, you will lift us up. We thank you that there is a lifting in you. I thank you that we may be down today, but at the right time, you're going to lift us up. And I thank you, God, that there is no place that is so low that your mighty hand cannot reach us. And I thank you, God, that even if you have to reach way down, you still have the power to lift us up. So we thank you that we are being lifted today. We obey the word that says that we are to cast our cares upon you. God, we confess many of us came in here worried about a lot of stuff, concerned about a lot of things. But in this moment, God, we give you everything that we care about. Finally, God, we ask you to help us to trust the process. Trust your hand. Trust your wisdom and your judgment. Trust, hallelujah, that whatever we're going through is according to your purpose and your plan. And at the right time, oh God, you will restore us, you will strengthen us, and you will settle us. And I pray today that those of us who have gathered here today are settled. No more going to and fro. Sometimes yes, and other times no, but we are settled. Settled in our minds. Settled in our convictions to serve you. Settle in our purpose, settle to pursue you with everything that we have, knowing that in the end, there is great reward. Touch everyone who's gathered here today, that their lives never be the same again. These blessings we ask you, receive them now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you clap your hands for the Lord? If you're here today, after hearing this message, you want to surrender your life over to God. I don't care what church you go to or how long you've been at church. Do you know that you could come to church every Sunday and still be walking away from God, not have a relationship with Him? Don't miss this moment here. This is a moment for somebody. I don't know who you are, but this is a moment for you to offer your life back up to God. I know it's been tough. You've wondered, God, if you love me, why would you allow this to happen? One thing after another. But guess what? You're here today because He loves you. I know some of us came for the baby dedication, and God says, yeah, I want you to celebrate the baby, but I also want you to know I love you, and I have a plan for you. And when I thought of Damien, I thought of this day, because I knew today would be the day that you needed to know that there is a reason why you're going through what you're going through, and I love you, and I have a plan. Ain't that good news? Hallelujah to God. If you desire prayer after we have closed, please come. Let us pray with you, encourage you in your relationship with the Lord. God is faithful. Clap your hands for Jesus one more time. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we love you. We thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness unto us. We thank you for your power because it is like no other power. I pray that you are moving on the hearts of everyone who have gathered here today, letting us know that you are faithful and that you are good and you have a purpose and plan for all that we go through. Thank you for this great day. Thank you for this family that's gathered here today and all of our visitors and friends who have gathered. I thank you, Lord, for this week is going to be a great week, and we're going to experience your power and your faithfulness. God, reveal to us things that were previously hidden. Spark our spiritual insight and discernment so that we are awake and aware of what's going on so that we can know what it is you would have us to do and to be. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming today. Hi, my name is Tim Brewington, and I am the pastor of Fellowship Church. Thank you for viewing this broadcast today. For more information about Fellowship Church, please check us out at www.thefellowshipmn.org. God bless you.